were a lot of young white musicians around the country who were trying to play jazz. Some of them were very talented musicians, some of them were not, as usual. But most of them, certainly all the good ones, knew that the really great figures in the music were black, and they were trying to play like them. They heard Louis Armstrong, they heard Ethel Waters sing, or Bessie Smith, they heard Coleman Hawkins. They said, wow, these guys are doing something with these instruments. I want to play that music. Big Spiderbeck was the first of the white musicians who had unmistakable genius. And so his importance to a lot of the young white musicians was, look, he proves it. He proves that we can play this music. It's possible for a white musician to make a real, original contribution to jazz.
Leon Bix Beiderbecke, one of the most promising and one of the most tragic figures in the history of jazz, emerged not from the great cities of New Orleans, Chicago, or New York, but from the rural heartland. He was born at 1934 Grand Avenue in Davenport, Iowa, on March 10, 1903. If his father, an industrious church-going Presbyterian, had had his way, his boy would never have played a note of jazz. From the age of three, Bix showed unusual musical ability. By the age of eight, he was outplaying his piano teacher. But he could not bear authority of any kind and never bothered to master more than the rudiments of written music, a failing that added to the self-doubt that would haunt him all his life. When his older brother returned from World War I with a wind-up Victrola and an armful of records, including Tiger Rag by the original Dixieland Jazz Band, Bix was transfixed. He played it over and over again, then borrowed a neighbor's cornet and began to imitate the raw new sounds he heard. Before long, he was hanging around the riverfront, listening to the jazz bands that performed aboard the steamboats that docked at Davenport. The musician who made the biggest impression on him was Louis Armstrong, who was then just beginning to make a name for himself.
So what would he have heard? Some kind of explosion, I think, of rhythm and sound possibilities that must have matched things inside him that he knew had nothing to do with what his parents wanted for him. And to hear this music would have broken all of that, and that was clearly what he needed to become something, to become himself.
Jazz music became his obsession, and Bix was soon good enough on the cornet to play alongside older musicians. And he often joined them behind the bandstand between sets to drink bootleg gin. His parents were horrified, and in 1921, abruptly pulled him out of high school and sent him off to a strict boarding school in Lake Forest, Illinois. If the Beiderbecks had hoped their son would abandon music or the musician's life, they were quickly disappointed. Lake Forest was only a short train ride away from Chicago, where Louis Armstrong would soon be playing the best jazz in America. Within a week of his arrival at school, Bix was writing home to tell his brother that he had talked his way into three black clubs on the South Side in eager search of what he called real jazz niggers. I'd go to hell, he wrote, to hear a good band.
A musician loves music and loves that instrument. And when they hear someone that's great on that instrument, there's a mixture of great envy, respect, and love. You're going out every night, you're hearing the greatest musician in the world play, Louis Armstrong, and all you want to do is be able to play. You've been told don't listen to them and they're not doing it, these are niggas and they ain't playing nothing and this is some coon music and it's all a joke, but you realize it's the most serious thing you've ever encountered in your life, and then you realize that you too are a part of it. It's got to be exhilarating and terrifying at the same time. Because to accept jazz music means that at a certain time you would have to accept something about the humanity of the United States Negro.
Bix slipped into the city so often to see and hear his heroes play that he was expelled from Lake Forest. His father angrily ordered him home to Iowa to work in the family coal business. Bix could bear only a few weeks of weighing coal before he returned to Chicago to hear and play the jazz music he loved. Nothing else seemed to matter to him. His clothes were unpressed. He mislaid possessions, forgot what day it was, carried his cornet in a paper bag. Music was the one thing that really brought him to life, a friend remembered. Not even whiskey could do it. And he gave it every chance.
Everybody drank in those years, of course. Social drinking was something that, especially in the music business, with its schedules and strange hours and everything, was rife. But Bix did it to extremes.
In 1924, Bix joined a band called the Wolverines, which played at roadhouses and clubs in Illinois, Indiana, and Ohio. When the Wolverines made their first records for Gannett, they were a hit, and Bix Beiderbecke was the star. Using an unorthodox system of fingering, he had developed a cornet style unlike anyone else's. Bright, clear, and crisp. Beiderbecke's distinctive sound, the guitarist Eddie Condon remembered, was like a girl saying, yes.
All my life, I'd been listening to music, but I had never heard anything remotely resembling what Bix Beiderbecke played. For the first time, I realized that music isn't all the same, that some people play so differently from others that it becomes an entirely new set of sounds. Eddie Condon.
The harmonies and the beautiful musical changes he played, that was something new. No one ever heard that play those beautiful changes like Bix Beiderbecke. No one.
In 1926, Bix started touring with the Gene Goldkett Orchestra, the hottest white dance band in America.
The first really great white jazz band, big band that is, was Gene Goldkett. This band was composed of fine musicians, and in the mid-20s, that band was unbelievable. I mean, they're still, you listen to a record like, as I say, Clementine, to this day, it swings like mad.
The musical leader of the Goldkett Orchestra and Bix's best friend in the band was the saxophone player Frank Trombauer, called Tram. They were opposites in many ways. Tram was debonair and businesslike. Bix was disorganized and insecure. But for a brief time, theirs would prove one of the most creative partnerships in jazz. In 1927, as the stock market soared to record heights, Trombauer and Bix recorded their greatest hit, Singin' the Blues. Trombauer's opening solo was light, relaxed, and supple.
and Beiderbecke's brilliant chorus picked up where Trombauer's left off.
He had that lyric quality, it had that rhythmic swing, that conversational effect, the sense of speech, the sense that somebody is talking to you, saying something very important.
Beiderbecke and Trombauer's recording of Singin' the Blues inspired a generation of young musicians, white and black, who would imitate it for years and quote from it for decades. Bix was becoming a success, but his estrangement from his father, his persistent self-doubt, and his growing dependence on alcohol threatened to sabotage everything he had achieved.
Bix loved jazz, but there are many kinds of love. Joyous, zestful, desperate. There's a kind of love that is a gloomy, confused dependency. Never fulfilled, and therefore insatiable. A love that asks more of its object than it can give. I felt that what Bix wanted for music, jazz never truly gave him.
One thing we talked about a lot was the freedom of jazz. People used to ask Bix to play a chorus just as he had recorded it. He couldn't do it. It's impossible, he told me once. I don't feel the same way twice. He said, that's one of the things I like about jazz, kid. I don't know what's gonna happen next. Do you? Jimmy McPartland.
In 1927, Gene Goldkett's orchestra disbanded, leaving Bix Beiderbecke and his friend Frankie Trombauer on their own. Then they heard from Paul Whiteman, the leader of the best-paid, most successful band in the country. Whiteman was eager to hire the best hot players to spice up his sound. He wanted, but did not dare hire black musicians. So he sought out the best white ones.
By 1926, 1927, jazz became a very powerful music, and Whiteman knew it. He got the best white musicians in the world. Bix Beiderbecke and Frank Trombauer and Eddie Lang and Joe Venuti were in the band. So for 2 or 3 years, Whiteman, though never really a jazz person, did make some very good jazz records.
Bix loved performing in the Whiteman band, and wrote home to his parents in Davenport to tell them that he had gotten a job with the best-known orchestra in America.
His letters home were, almost at the end of his life, full of the kind of subtext which is, in its truest sense, an entreaty. Respect me. Approve of me. Look, I'm playing with the top band in the country. I'm making all these records. We're playing at fancy dress balls. Can't you be proud of me for that? His mother was, I think, fairly sympathetic. His father never yielded.
In the summer of 1928, the Whiteman Orchestra played the Chicago Theater. Sitting in the segregated balcony, Louis Armstrong, who years before had inspired the young Beiderbecke, saw him play on stage for the first time. Those pretty notes went right through me, Armstrong remembered. And several days that week, In the early morning hours at a Southside club, Bix got a chance to play with the man he most admired. We would lock the doors, Armstrong recalled, and just blow. We tried to see how good we could make the music sound. But Bix Beiderbecke would never get the chance to record or to play in public with Louis Armstrong. Even at the height of the jazz age, the music world remained strictly segregated.
I think, my God, this poor man, he should have been playing with one of the black orchestras. And I believe it harmed him. In that way, he was a victim artistically. Let's leave emotions aside. Emotionally, he was a victim of many things, but he was a victim artistically of segregation. He was not allowed to play with musicians who were as good as, and in some cases better than he. That's what jazz musicians need.
Bix Beiderbecke's tragedy is an American tragedy. It's about the white man who understands how far our culture is and our society is from what it should be. And this music has given him a glimpse of what is. And this is a man whose hearing is so deep into the meaning of this music that it broke his heart.
On November 30th, 1928, Bix Beiderbecke checked into the Palace Hotel in Cleveland with the rest of the Paul Whiteman Orchestra. They were to begin a week-long run that evening. Bix was having more and more trouble controlling his drinking and the depression that it seemed only to intensify. He had been missing concerts, forgetting his cues, hiding bottles beneath the bandstand. Many years later, a cornetist, using copies of Paul Whiteman's sheet music, discovered a notation in someone's hand: "Wake up, Bix." Whiteman urged him to go home to Davenport to recuperate. But when Bix got there, he discovered in a hall closet all the records he had proudly sent home to his parents. They had never listened to them.
He wasn't being good to himself. His feet were swollen and dragged when he walked. His thoughts were often muddled. He came to the studio and sat for hours at the piano. It hurt me all over, in my eyes, in my brain, in my stomach, in my heart. But I knew nothing could help him. I suppose a guy gets closer to you when he's hurting himself, and all you can do is watch. Eddie Condon.
Bix quietly checked himself into a treatment center, managed to stay sober for a while, then fell off the wagon again, and was never well enough to rejoin the Whiteman band. By August of 1931, he was living alone in a borrowed one-room apartment in Queens, New York.
He died in the midst of an attack of DTs in a squalid little apartment in Queens at 9:30 in the evening, with nobody around to help him.
Bix Beiderbecke was not yet 29. Lots of cats tried to play like Bix, Louis Armstrong said later. Ain't none of them play like him yet.